Well, hey kiddos, here we are live on CapZeyeZ. You've picked a great rainy evening to stay in. That, of course, was Stevie Ray Vaughan doing Little Wing. And this is CapZeyeZ. Dave Pruitt with Nasty Nathan coming up in a little while. Me, I'm Troy Dillinger, and I'm sitting here with an Austin luminary, Mr. Paul Ray of Paul Ray and the Cobras. Of the Austin Music Awards. He's the host of that every year, and he's also got a great radio show, or a couple great radio shows. My favorite is Twine Time on KUT. Thanks. FM 90.5.
Thanks.
Paul Ray's here, kids. We're going to talk to him, and if you want to start calling in, if you got a question for Mr. Paul Ray, the number is...
Call me, kids.
472-2255. I was noticing while we're first for the audience, the Cobras was one of the first bands Stevie was in. Stevie Ray was.
Yeah, it was one of the first bands here in Austin that he was in. That's true.
Yeah, and I could, when we were watching the video, it kind of evoked some pretty strong images in it. I kind of looked over at you a couple times. It looked like you were kind of moved through some of that.
Yeah, it's neat to see.
What are your memories of playing with Stevie?
Oh my! I knew him a long time, and he played with us 3 years, all the time. So you know, it's like he was in the band for 3 years. So I got too many to single any particular ones out. But I knew him a long time because I'd known his brother since the early 60s, so I knew Stevie when he was like a little kid. And then he came to Austin and he could play. And he joined us in, I think, 75, joined the band in Dallas in 75 because we needed another. I had Denny Freeman as the other guitar player, so I had Denny Freeman and Stevie Vaughan in the same band at the same time, so it was pretty phenomenal.
Guitar heavy.
It was a pretty serious band, it really was. And it was such a treat. He was with it 3 years, and then he decided he wanted to front his own band and started Triple Threat with Lou Ann Barton and W.C. Clark and Mike Kindred and Freddie Walden.
So what was probably the paint us a little picture of one of the finest moments that you've seen him with Stevie at?
Oh my, there's so many of them. Every time that somebody would come into town to play one of the famous blues people like were in that video we just saw, Clifford Antone would always get Stevie up there, you know. Oh yeah, look at this. And he always burned pretty bright when that happened. He could play. Kid could play.
That's great.
Yeah, he was great. When Albert, the famous story, I think it's probably folklore by now, but the famous story is when Albert King came to play at Antone's on 6th Street, Clifford got him up there to play, and he started just really burning. And Albert went over and opened the curtain, hit his guitar, and said, "I want you to see this, honey." Hit his guitar behind the curtain. It was great.
Wow. Okay, well, let's move on, because there's so much more that you are and have been involved with in the town. You got here, are you from Austin, or?
No, I'm from Dallas. I grew up in Dallas, but I came down here to go to school in 1960, to go to college at UT, and got involved with a band down here, and then when everybody flunked out, we went back to Dallas and started playing up there. And back then, this was in the early 60s, so when you got a gig, you played 6 nights a week, Sunday matinee, and wore matching suits and showed up at the office, you know, and played every night. And you only played 8 to midnight to 1 on Saturday, so it wasn't too bad. And I was young and eager, you know.
Where were some of the places that you played in Austin in 1960?
Well, we played a lot of fraternity parties. This was before Hatchet got control of all the fraternity parties. It was only a few places, the Jade Room, New Orleans, Lake Austin Inn, but we didn't play there very often. It was sort of like more of a fraternity, sorority, party type thing when we first started. And then when we went back to Dallas, we played in clubs up there a lot, every night of the week for months.
So you go back up to Dallas, you're playing in Dallas, and then what brings you back to Austin?
In 70, 69, 70, everybody got out of Dallas and either went to California or came here. And I came back from California to Dallas and said, "I got to get out of here." And my girlfriend at the time, who's my wife now, I was going to go to school at UT, so we just said, hey, let's go. We're out, because Austin was such a great place. We'd come down here and play at the Vulcan and have a great time. Have a great time playing.
Yeah. Let's see. The scene here when you came in 69 to 70, what was that like?
It was real different then. There was I'm trying to think. There weren't too many. Sheva's Headband, the Hub City Movers. Mm-hmm. This is all the people that played at the opening of the Armadillo. We got her at the same time the Armadillo opened, mm-hmm. that summer. It all happened that one summer when everybody hit the town at the same time, 69, 70, that era. And I was trying to think who all the Freddie King played down here a lot. Mm-hmm. He was in town a lot. And people like Mother Earth and people like that. Joplin would come back to town and go out to Catfish Place and or go to the Thread Gills when it was still a filling station you could buy a beer before it became a restaurant.
So you do the Cobras? And
well, actually, when I came down here, I wasn't in a band when I first got here, but I had played with Jimmy Vaughn and Jamie Bassett and Phil Campbell in Dallas in a band called Texas Storm. Mm-hmm. We played the Whiskey A Go-Go in Hollywood and a place called The Experience on Sunset Strip in Hollywood. And came back, had a really weird experience with L.A. and rock and roll and all that stuff, and came back and came down here, and I started playing bass with The Storm, which was Jimmy's band. He turned Texas Storm into The Storm.
Jimmy Vaughn?
Yeah, Jimmy Vaughn, and with Denny Freeman and Doyle Bramhall, and it's a great band. Anyway, I started being a bass player, and I played bass with him for a long time, and then I played drums with him for 6 months because the drummer cut his wrist, so I got to be a drummer for 6 months, and then quit that band. Wanted to be a singer again, and went to California and did another record thing through a friend with Grunt Records. Grunt Records, Hot Tuna. He was a guy from Waco that I'd played with in clubs in Dallas, and he was one of our friends. He had played with Jimmy also, but anyway, went out and did this demo thing, and it had horns, and they were looking for folk singers with three names, you know, and stuff, so, you know, that had cowboy hats, and I didn't, so came back here and started Paul Rand the Cobras because Denny Freeman and Alex Napier mm-hmm. had just come back with Southern Feeling with W.C. and Angela Straley and W.C. Clark. They were up in somewhere up in the northwest, Seattle, I think. And this is a long story. And Paul Rand the Cobras started in 74, and then Stevie joined in 75, and he quit in 77, I quit in 78, and the band went on with about 20 or 30 members all the way to 1980-something. It was still going. Mm-hmm. There were guys, a guy cut my hair one time and said, hey, man, I'm in the Cobras. I'm going, I know, I don't even know this. It was pretty crazy.
That's great.
Yeah.
Man, there's so much stuff, and I know, I mean, we're probably going to breeze over some of the best stuff, but you, please interject anything that seems important here, because there's such a wealth of information. I don't think an hour is going to be enough to cover it all. Let's take a few calls. Let's
sure.
see what the folks
sure.
have to say out there.
Up to the peoples.
Hello, you're live on CapZeyeZ. Yes.
Yeah. Am I on the CapZeyeZ?
You sure are.
Okay, I was calling just to say, when are y'all going to be getting some good bands coming in?
Well, we get the bands on Tuesday night. If you watch Tuesday night from 12 to 1 here on Channel 10, that's when Dave does the live bands. All righty. Hello, caller. You're live on CapZeyeZ.
Yeah, I want to speak to Paul.
Speak.
You played with Stevie?
Yeah.
Who else have you played with?
Well, I played with a lot of people in this around town here. I played in The Storm, Louis Cowdery, Jimmy Vaughn, Mike Kindred, Doyle Bramhall, Big Doyle Bramhall, Doyle Sr. I don't know.
Have you played with Jimmy Vaughn?
Yes, in a band in Dallas called The Storm, and down here in a band called The Storm.
Okay. Yep. Well,
he also played on that RCA demo that I was talking about that I made in California. He came out and played on that too. And he's a genius. That guy's got great ideas. He's a genius.
Well, far out.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
All right, thanks, man. Hello, caller. You're live on CapZeyeZ.
To Roy.
Yes.
Hey, how's it going?
I'm doing okay. Is this Joe?
Yeah, it's he.
What's going on, man?
Hey, man, I got a question for your guest here.
For Paul?
I really like that T-shirt. Do they make a Stevie T-shirt like that?
Antone's.
Yes.
Antone's Boutique.
That's really cool.
They do have a Stevie T-shirt, don't they?
Yeah, they probably got about a dozen of them.
Yeah.
Antone's has a lot of stuff like that. You can get Kim Wilson T-shirts, Jimmy Vaughn T-shirts.
Right.
Go to the Antone's Boutique and ask for Susan.
Who you know fairly well, correct?
Susan Antone?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
You've spent a bit of time over there.
I played over there. And my wife used to run the place a long time ago.
She's still working over there, correct?
No, No. She worked there for 3 or 4 years or something, and then she worked at La Zona Rosa until just recently.
Oh, okay. I was under the impression that she was still working over there.
I'd been there a while. It's been 2 or 3 years.
My mistake.
That's no big deal.
I guess Joe hung up. Anyways, let's see. Let's take a couple more calls here, and then we're going to go back to videos. Hello, caller. You're
Hello,
live
Paul.
On CapZeyeZ. Yes.
Hi, Paul.
Hi.
Hello.
I really enjoy everything you do. Love Twine Time.
Thanks.
I think it's marvelous. I want to ask you two questions. Did you ever know Bob Brown with the Conquerors?
Yeah.
Whatever. Do you know where he is?
Last I heard, he was in California, but I don't know.
About Bob Dogan more recently?
Wow, Bob Dogan. Bob Dogan was in the Cobras.
Right. That's where I first saw him.
Last I heard, he was down here. He went from Chicago to Miami to get on a cruise ship and had like an appendectomy or something, and they wouldn't let him on the ship. And he came here and stayed as long as he could, and I think he's back in Chicago.
Well, I'll be.
Yeah,
well,
I played a CD on my jazz show the other day that he was playing on.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I'd love to see more of your work and more of your some music videos by you.
Not many of those.
Well,
let's
get it going.
All right.
We will have one coming up very shortly.
All right. And I really love the video you just did a while ago. It was magnificent. It really touched my heart.
Yeah. Hey, thanks a lot for calling.
Bye.
Hello, caller. You're live on CapZeyeZ.
Hello?
Yes.
Man, you was a bunch of fucking homos.
Thanks for waiting to say that. Hello, you're live on CapZeyeZ.
How long did it take that kid to work up the courage to call up and say that over the phone?
Hold on for a second.
You know, when you leave your finger on the button, it hangs up on me.
Whoops.
Yeah.
So, well, yeah, hey.
So, for a dollar, Troy.
Yes, sir? Okay, well, see, that wasn't even me. That's one of our games, for a dollar. Do something real embarrassing. Hello, caller. Goodbye, caller. I think they hung up on us. Okay.
Hey, dude, when are you going to play that song, Sweat Into the Oldies?
Sweat?
Yeah.
Okay, we're live on CapZeyeZ with Paul Ray. Have you got a question?
Hey, how's it going?
Doing just fine. How about you?
I was going to see if Paul remembered a gig I saw one time at the Antone's when it was a short period. It was up on Anderson Lane. It was the Cobras, and I think it was the first time I saw Charlie. And he was like 12 or 13 years old.
Hmm. Gosh, yeah. I used to play at AJ's, which is now Antone's, when it was Hondo's and it was a pizza place.
15
anyway,
other places.
Yeah, with Charlie and WC, and it was sort of like the oldest guys in town and the youngest guy in town all playing, and when he was 12. And yeah, well, he's played all his life. There's a kid that played all his life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I take it you were there, sir.
Yeah, I had just moved to town about a year before.
Oh, that's great.
There have been a lot of those. I mean, there's a lot of great nights that, boy, I can't remember. I remember all of them, but I can't single any of them out.
Yeah. Well, that was the first time I'd seen you, I think, and Little Charlie. Anyway, I enjoyed it.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for calling. Well, hey, you're watching CapZeyeZ. I'm Troy Dillinger, sitting here with Paul Ray. We're going to go to a few videos here. This first
one in the Caribbean.
Oh,
the same in every city. Every city has a part of town that is not pretty. The sirens sound the same in every city. From LA to New York City, to New York City.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, we're back. This is CapZeyeZ Live Saturday, or it's probably Sunday morning now. Yes, that would be. It does that after midnight, turns into the next day. This is Dave Pruitt's CapZeyeZ gig thing with Nasty Nathan waving at us.
Hey, he's not sure.
Okay, he's not. That was Michael E. Johnson and the Killer Bees from the Austin Music Awards show this year. Man, I'm out of it. Hello, we're sitting here with Paul Ray. Paul Ray and the Cobras of the Austin Music Awards of KUT's Twine Time. And what's the name of the jazz show?
Paul Ray's Jazz.
Paul Ray's Jazz.
I didn't name it, but that's what the name of it is.
And are those the only two shows that you're doing on
KUT? Yes, Tuesday and Wednesday Jazz from 8 to midnight, and Saturday night, 6 to 9, Twine Time, which is rhythm and blues, mostly old 45s.
This guy knows how to pick music that pleases the ear, I tell you what.
Music. There's a lot of good music out there.
So how's this Austin Music Award thing going?
Well, it's just a once a year deal when everybody just gets together and has a party and passes pieces of paper around just as an excuse to have a party. It's a lot of fun.
And you're like the dean.
Well, I became the MC. I started out the first year as a guest presenter with Ann Barton, and we were on the very first set of awards, and nobody was there, so we were all night going, and the winner is, you know, like that. And the next year, I was one of three, and the next year, I was one of two, and then at some point, they said, would you like to do it, and I'll, you know, just do it all, so that's when I started doing it.
So it's kind of like, it's become, it seems like it's also almost synonymous. Like this year you were on the poster.
Oh, yeah, it was Margaret Moser did that.
Yeah.
Because it was like 10 years I'd done every award show in some capacity or another. I'd presented awards starting out as just a part-time deal and ended up being the MC for the last 5 years, has it been? You'd have to ask one of those guys over there, Jeff, or one of those guys that keeps up with all that stuff.
Yeah. Well, you know we had Margaret on the show a while back.
No, I didn't, but that's a good one. That's a good.
And you were also on another poster, were you not playing guitar? It was kind of an unnamed thing. Mm-hmm. Maybe it was just one of the, like a Guy Juke poster for something.
My name
else
was on a Guy Juke poster on a guitar that a lot of people signed. He had me sign. Mm-hmm. And my name was on that, but I'm not much of a guitar player. I played guitar just this much.
Yeah.
I haven't played much guitar.
Supposedly it was you, this picture. That's what I was told.
Oh, no, I don't think so. I don't think so.
Then again, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
So we're talking about I've already forgotten about the name of the place. It was on Red River.
Oh, the One Night.
The One Night.
Famous One Night. Yeah, it was a Pass the Hat joint at 8th and Red River, around from the police station, and no cover. A lot of Harleys parked at the curb, and they had the Storm on Monday night with Lewis Cowder and Jimmy Vaughn and those guys on Monday night, and then Tuesday night was Angela and the Rockets, which is Angela with Jimmy and Lewis, and Wednesday night was Paul Ray and the Cobras, Thursday night the Night Crawlers with Stevie Vaughn and Drew Pennington and Doyle Bramhall and Keith Ferguson. And it was like every night of the week, all these guys playing. It was a crazy place.
And all you had to do was just walk in.
Just walk in and yeah. Just walk in. Or ride your motorcycle in like one guy did.
Nowadays you're paying $5-$10 to see these people.
Well, yeah, well, it was really something because our girlfriends had to pass the hat. And that's pretty crazy, you know, they'd wear short shorts and cutoffs and halter tops and go around and get us money from the bikers. It was all right.
But yeah, that's the kind of grassroots scene that it was back then.
They gave us free beer. We ended up making, you know, $1.60 each. They want a good night. You know, on a good night, we'd make $5 a piece, you know. And God, I was telling you, a lot of places we played, we ended up owing tabs bigger than what we made.
It's the Blues Brothers syndrome.
Oh God, yeah.
So okay, so what was going on for you in the 80s? What was happening?
That's when I started doing Twine Time in the late, when I quit the Cobras. Not too long after that, I started doing Twine Time, and so all the 80s I was doing that. And also, I worked for Ray Hennig for a while and stuff like that. You know, just he gave me a job because I went in and said, hire me, man. I need a job. So he gave me a job soldering wires in the back of his store for a while until I could get going again.
He's helped a lot of people out.
Yeah, he has. Yeah. He's quite a guy.
So, yeah, it's like, it seems like it, every time, everything you turn, every time you turn around, something in the music scene was like, oh, Paul Ray's done that. Paul Ray was here. He's done this and that.
It's just that everybody else got famous and left, and I'm still here.
Well, you must have an incredible record collection to pull the music together like you do for Twine Time.
They're not all mine. A friend of mine, Gary Howell, and I started putting this thing together, and the bulk of it came from a guy in Waco whose ex-wife sold him out of her mother's house while the guy was gone, sort of deal. So he sort of in a trust. We're sort of keeping them, and they're letting me play them on the radio, sort of affair. But we put this thing together, some of mine, a lot of his, a lot of those, and we've bought more. And it's a big bunch of records. It's a lot of records, but it's a lot of good records. That's the good part of it.
And there's a lot of stuff that is kind of fairly obscure.
Yeah.
That almost has kind of a cult following. I mean, it's like there's songs that you'll hear on Twine Time, and then you'll maybe hear someone covering the next week at Antone's, or you know, it's
a
like,
lot of taping going on.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but that's all right, because I do the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, on my, because somebody commented that one of my shows, Sarah Brown commented one of my shows when I did my favorite singers. She said it just sounds like one of your set list.
Right. Yeah.
You could, same stuff.
You could real easily build a set list out of that show.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of bands have.
Let's go to the phone here. Hello, caller, you're live on CapZeyeZ.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Doing great.
I'm coming from transplant, from California. And that guy, Paul Ray, I recognized. And I've been listening to y'all talk for about an hour. I've been on the phone for about 45 minutes waiting to talk to this man.
Thanks for waiting.
And, oh, no problem, man. It's a good show. And, I can't place him. I don't know where I saw him in California. But
Where in California were you?
I'm in Redlands, but I was in L.A. a lot, working, and just hitting a lot of little clubs and watching the music scene. And I was really surprised when I heard you talking that you were from Austin, or did a lot of music in Texas, Central Texas, I guess.
Well, I hung out in San Francisco for a while.
Yeah.
In the late 60s, I went out there a couple of times, and...
Also,
hung out in the Sausage Alito for a while.
Oh, yeah.
I was doing that hot tuna thing. And,
yeah.
And, well, there's a strange place.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's different.
Whoa, rock stars and airline stewardesses. You can't even get anything to eat there. It's crazy. But anyway, we had a library card. We were there for a while. In L.A., I was just in L.A. just on rock and roll business.
Well, see, I don't know where I've seen you, you know. Just
Post
after
office.
Listening to you talk, you know, I kind of snapped and I called and talked to Nathan. I said, man, I know that guy from somewhere, and it's not here.
Do I owe you money?
No, you don't owe me money.
Then it's
we
cool,
didn't even
man.
Shoot a game of pool.
Yeah.
But after listening to you talk, you know, I mean, you played with everybody around town, man. It's just amazing.
Well, like I said, I'm the only one left. Everybody's famous guy.
I'd like to know when your show airs, because I'd like
Saturday
to hear
Saturday night, 6 to 9, is the R&B show, and then Tuesday and Wednesday, 8 to midnight, it's the jazz program.
Well, I'm kind of an old old blues freak, you know. I mean, old blues, like 30s, 40s, 20s. And my dad just picked up guitar like 10 years ago, and he's 55 now, and he's jamming in the backyard every day, and he's got all these old blue tunes. And
wait a minute, you said we're the same age and your dad's 55?
Yes.
How old do you think I am?
That's a tough question. I'm 36.
Oh, I'm almost as old as your dad.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to be 50 in August.
Are you shitting me?
Hey, man.
Can I say that? I guess so.
I'm Presbyterian.
Well, listen, man, you guys have a cool show. Austin is great. I'm just learning the scene here and checking out some clubs, and I hope to catch you on the show here in town. How do I find out where you're playing?
Watch the papers, watch the Chronicle, watch the Statesman, the Salesman, and I don't know. It's coming up pretty soon. I'm playing at Antone's with Lou Ann Barton coming up.
Yeah.
And I'm also playing in the park. On a show for Save Barton Creek Association in early June the 7th. I'm playing June the 5th at Antone's, June the 7th in the park, and then I think I might be doing June the 15th with the Big and Tall Band at Antone's, which is the band, man. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it sounds cool.
Check those
when you
guys
say the park,
out.
What does that mean exactly? I mean, where is the park?
Zilker Hillside Theater over by Barton Springs Pool. There's a little stage. They do shows. Hey, let's put on a show.
All right, man. It's nice talking to you. Y'all be good.
Yeah, thanks for calling. Welcome to Austin, by the way. Hello, caller. You're live on CapZeyeZ.
Yes, I'd just like to say I appreciate all the work that Paul has done with KUT and for the city of Austin. I had a question. This may not be the forum, but I was wondering what his opinion was of heavy metal or this, the hard rock, like screw and all that. I personally, I do not understand it. And,
what's your high school music? What year did you get out of high school?
Actually, 79, but...
Okay, so that's your music. And that's what you really love and understand and stuff. And if you remember, probably your old man hated it. Probably said, oh, I don't play that stuff in my car. Because my old man didn't like my Hangabout or the Midnighter stuff either. And, you know, it was... He thought the Drifter's White Christmas was sacrilegious. So it's just a matter of it's... There's so many great musics out there. It doesn't matter. If you don't like it, there's two knobs on the radio, man.
Just, sure, and I appreciate that. I'm just wondering where you see the quality in that. I mean, I think I come pretty much from the school that you come from as far as the older music. And
yeah. It's not my favorite kind of music, but I just say if they like it, man, you know, do this. You know, if you like it.
It's all right. Freedom to do what you want.
Exactly.
To do.
There's some great music out there, and it's all great. There's just, you know, play it.
Right on.
Hello.
Hello. How are you?
Paul?
Yes.
I had a question. I was curious if you had ever seen Little Walter Jacobs perform.
No, No, I never get to see him play. He passed away long before I had the chance to ever see him.
All right, thanks for calling.
Boy, I wish I had, though. Guy playing electric harmonica like that, my goodness.
Hello, caller, are you there?
Yeah, I think so, most of the time.
Okay.
I'm fair to partly cloudy.
All right.
I heard you're voting Republican coming up in the election. Is that true?
No, I'm writing in Jimmy Vaughn.
Okay.
Jimmy Vaughn for president. We're starting right now.
Jimmy Vaughn.
We'll get him on the ballot in a couple of states, maybe a city or two.
Looks like I've seen old pictures of you from the early 70s. Your hair is longer now than it was then.
I'm older.
Oh, is that what it is? Because you used to have short hair.
Oh, man, it comes and goes. I just hate haircuts.
Yeah, well, at least, you know, you save money on haircuts. You know, I don't have to buy too much toilet paper. But anyway, regarding music, I listen to your show every Saturday night, whether you like it or not. And I'm a quasi-expert on music from the 60s and 70s. Predominantly, it's called rock and roll.
Uh-huh.
Blues, bass, psychedelic, hard rock, not heavy metal. The word wasn't even invented back then. It seems like the music nowadays is controlled and managed so much. It's commercialized. It has a common denominator among it, and... you know, I think the classic area was 64 when the Beatles arrived till the early 70s. And radio stations, they're so, there's a lot of people out here who miss the old, old stuff. It's obscure. Somewhere between what you play and the stuff coming out nowadays. John Mayall's Blues Breakers, Paul Butterfield Blues Band.
Oh, you're
Candy.
Talking about British Invasion and that.
Yeah, well, yeah. Where do you get it? I mean, your station that you're on, that's playing right now, Alternate Wave with Howie Ritchie, there's no other conduit. I'm sick and tired of Megadeth, and it's all geared to younger kids now. The demographics have changed over the years.
That's what that show is. Yeah, well, that's what always happens, though. I mean, the kids want their own music, and that's what happens. I think you're right. I think in 1970, Led Zeppelin came along, and then there was a whole other kind of music that came out of that, which is they called it rock back then, you know, rock music, and so they kind of took it off. Those guys took it off in that direction, and so that's what you got.
Yeah, but disco came out in the mid-70s, and then
disco was definitely a record company hype.
Right, and then so-called new wave, and which is watered-down punk, I guess.
Well, it started out as a real deal. It's just that all these guys wanted, you know, all these hipsters wanted to hang out with these guys, and they co-opted them, and you know, That's what happens.
I think music nowadays goes in cycles. I think we're going to get back to vocalization, harmony, where you can understand the words to the music, and just yelling into a microphone and a bunch of blazing guitars. You know, I think it's going to go back into another cycle again.
You sound like what my dad used to say about Chuck Berry.
I like Chuck Berry, but...
I know, my dad used to say what you just said about Megadeth.
Well, anyway, there's a lot of aging right-wing hippies out here, and I know you're one of them. So, I just wanted to comment on that. Radio today sucks, and a lot of the music does. A lot of stuff they call talent, I can do a lot better than that, and I don't even know how to play guitar. We'll see you next time.
All right. So that's the whole deal. See, the rock and roll is the most democratic. It's the only democratic thing left in the world. Anybody can be in a rock and roll band. It doesn't matter. That's the only thing that's democratic anymore is rock and roll. You can be in a rock and roll band. Just do it. Just get your rock and roll band.
And give it enough time, and it'll be recycled again. If you liked it once, they'll probably steal it and make something new out of it before too long. We're going to go to a couple calls, and we'll be do a couple calls and then videos. Hello.
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 Hey, Troy, this is Philip.
Hey! What's going on?
Oh, nothing. I was
just guitar players.
Flipping through the channels and saw you on here. I haven't talked to you in a couple months, and I thought I'd come and say hey and find out what you were doing.
Look who I got here. I got Paul Ray here.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. You ever listen to his radio show?
No.
Twine Time? You need to. It comes on like 6 to 9.
Yeah, I've heard about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is the big Philip that used to play with me in Lucky 13.
What are you doing musically now, Troy?
Well, I'm putting something new together, and it's just kind of happening at its own pace, and it'll be around when it's around.
Cool.
I guess, you know. Hey, you know what you need to do?
What do I need
to
do?
Will you call my machine and leave your new number?
All right.
Okay. Well, hey, I'm gonna let you go, and I'll talk to you soon, okay?
Okay, take care, Troy.
Okay, see you, man.
Mm, bye.
Bye. It's my buddy. Hello.
Paul. Paul.
Hello.
Yeah, how close were you with Stevie?
I knew him.
You don't care.
Well, thanks for your concern.
What do you want to say?
Okay, last call. And,
Hey.
Hello.
Hey, I can't hear you guys on my phone.
You gotta turn your TV up.
It's totally off, the sound is.
Turn your TV up.
Okay, I'm like 10 feet away from it. Anyway, I'm working overnight at this like state institution, whatever. I just wanted to call and say, Paul, you're impressive. You have this great attitude towards music. It's so rare. It's a true, I gotta say, man, it looks like a true love. I mean, totally, it's amazing. You know, you're saying some amazing things.
Oh, well thanks.
I can't hear what you're saying. But anyway, I love your show. I'm one of these, you know, younger 20s kind of alternative people, you know, one of these people that likes these bands that these guys are calling about, and I just have to say that I totally love your show, and I think it's great. And I gotta say,
thanks.
There's one thing that I do think that is great about the modern rock, of course the modern rock music corporate machine or whatever, it's pretty evil, and they can chew people up and spit them out, but we've got this thing now where bands can actually start in a club, make their own record with their own money, and through the underground, magazines, clubs that are run by kids, record companies that are run by kids, you can make your own record like R.E.M. did, like U2 did, and in 5 or 6 years you can be number one. And I think that all the alternative music that's happening now is just great because it's in the people's hands, you know. Megadeth started the same way. They made their own first record, and it's great. You know, that's all I want to say.
All right. Thanks a lot for calling.
Thanks. That is true. You can, when we made records back when we first started playing in the early 60s, it was sort of like a business card. You made a record to get gigs. And it's a whole different thing. Of course, back then, the main thing that you were shooting for was Vegas. I mean, there weren't arenas and concerts and stuff like that. That was after Woodstock that we had concerts. So it was sort of like you got a gig, and if you were good enough, you ended up in Vegas at 4 o'clock in the morning playing for, you know, a bunch of drunks or something. So it's changed completely. Now you can make, like you said, make your own record and become R.E.M.
And I think when it comes down to it, if it's good rock and roll, somebody don't like it.
Oh yeah, well, that's the beauty of it. I mean, there's stuff I don't like either, but so what? I mean, you know.
I think that's going to be one of the easiest labels in the future of what rock and roll is. pisses somebody off.
That's one of the criterion.
You're watching CapZeyeZ with me and Paul Ray, and we're going to do some videos, and we'll be back shortly. I believe this is Lou Ann Barton with Rocket in My Pocket.
Sherry was a waitress at the only joint in town. She had a reputation as a girl who'd been around. Down Main Street after midnight, a brand new pack of cigs, a fresh one hanging from her lips, a beer between her legs. She'd ride down to the river, meet with all her friends. The road goes on forever, and the party never ends. Sonny was a loner, older than the rest. He was going in the Navy, but he couldn't pass the test. So he hung around town, sold a little pot. The law caught wind of Sonny. One day he got caught, but he was back in business, and they set him free again. The road goes on forever, and the party never ends. Now Sonny's playing eight ball at the joint where Sherry works. When some drunken out-of-towner put his hand up Sherry's skirt, Sonny took his pool cue, laid the drunk out on the floor, stuffed a dollar in her tip jar, and he walked on out the door. She's running right behind him, reaching for his hand. The road goes on forever, and the party never ends. They jump in Sonny's pickup. He jams her down in gear. Sonny looks at Sherry, said, let's get on out of here. The stars were high above them. The moon was in the east. The sun was setting on them. When they reached Miami Beach, they got a motel by the water and a quart of Bombay gin. The road goes on forever and the party never ends. They soon ran out of money, but Sonny knew a man who knew some Cuban refugees who dealt in contraband. Sonny met the Cubans in a house just off the route with a briefcase full of money and a pistol in his boot. The cards were on the table when the law came busting in. The road goes on forever and the party never ends. Yeah, the Cubans grabbed the goodies. Sonny grabbed the jack. He broke the bathroom window and he climbed on out the back. Sherry drove the pickup through the alley on the side where a lawman tackled Sonny and was reading him his rights. She stops out in the alley with a single shot 410. The road goes on forever and the party never ends. They left the lawman lying there. They made their getaway. They got back to the motel just before the break of day. Sonny gave her all the money and he blew her a little kiss. If they ask you how this happened, say I forced you into this. She watched him as his taillights disappeared around the bend. The road goes on forever and the party never ends. It's Main Street after midnight, just like it was before. 21 months later, at the local grocery store, Sherry buys a paper and a cold six-pack of beer. The headlines read that Sonny is going to the chair. She drives back into Main Street in her new Mercedes Benz. The road goes on forever, and the party never ends.
Ah, yeah, I get to sing again. I haven't done this in a while. It's called Ain't Gonna Be a Crying Towel.
Hello, we're back on CapZeyeZ with Paul Ray. That was Paul Ray.
That was awful.
he's absolving himself of
he was out of breath is what he was.
Yeah, it happens.
Hey.
It happens. I hadn't sung in a while either. My breath is out. I'm out of breath too. Hey.
But the suit looked good, huh?
Yeah, that was a very cool suit. You got that mod thing going.
Oh, yeah.
So we had Paul Ray with, I guess that was the Antones, correct?
Yeah.
And before that was Joe Ely, and before that was Lou Ann Barton with Rockin' in My Pocket. And let me do a little business here real quick. We got Inner Soul Rock and Roll with Aerial Dream, May the 19th. At the back room, passes available at Austin Music Stores. Look, a flyer. Wow. And tonight's sponsor is the band Co-op. We'd like to welcome them on board. I'm going to do Paul Harvey now. This is Paul.
Page two.
Harvey. Backside of page one. Call Randy over there at 339-2101. Once again, thanks to the band Co-op for sponsoring CapZeyeZ. If you're interested in sponsoring CapZeyeZ, there'll be a number up here that you can, it'll say for more information, call, la-da-da-da-da-da. That is the number, la-da-da-da-da-da. You can just call up and leave a message or any information for the show. There it is. There's a number. Call that number for more information, or if you want to sponsor CapZeyeZ, or if you want to marry Dave or his wife, Teresa, whose birthday it is. Happy birthday, Teresa. Ha! And let's see, what else? If you want to see somebody on the show, video requests, anything, you can call. For more information, call 473-3848. Page 2. Okay, we're back here with Paul Ray, and we're going to take a couple more phone calls. We're going to close it up. Once again, the radio show's Paul Ray's Jazz is on
Tuesday and Wednesday night, 8 to midnight.
And Twine Time is?
Saturday, 6 to 9 p.m.
And you have dances, too, Twine Time
Yeah,
dances.
We have a back-to-school dance. We're going to do a school's out dance for the little monsters. we did a Valentine dance, and it was all love songs, slow songs. So I said, we'll have a dance for the little kids. So we're going to do that, and it'll be just a bunch of rock and roll. It'll be great.
I like it. You do all these theme shows. You do like Mother's Day.
Yeah.
And you do, and the dances. I think it's great.
Christmas show and 4th of July's greatest hits. Bunch of stuff.
Yeah. It's magic, kids.
Nah, rock and roll.
Don't cheat yourself by not listening. Okay. And once again, KUT is 90.5 FM. You can just get it on your regular radio dial. Don't need no cable. Don't need nothing. Except a radio. Okay, hello caller, you're live on CapZeyeZ.
Yeah, I've got a question for Paul.
Shoot.
Paul, you said you played in the music scene back in the Dallas in the late 60s.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever hear of a band called Kenny and the Casuals band?
Yeah. Kenny Daniels, yeah, I knew those guys.
Oh, really? Well, great. Yeah, I'm a good friend of Kenny's.
I was in a band called the Bricks.
Oh, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
I still see Kenny play all the time in Dallas.
Yeah, he's still doing it.
Yep, the Casuals still together, I think, since 64.
Yeah, I think he's like selling Toyotas or something, too. I don't know.
No, I'm selling hardware now.
Ah, all right, Kenny.
I'll tell him you said hi.
Yeah, I do.
All right, thanks a lot, man.
Yeah.
Great, thanks for calling in. You never know who's watching the show. That's a great thing.
Yeah.
That's how we got you on the show.
That's right, I was watching.
Yeah.
Steve Beaton.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Oh, it's our boys again. Hey, boys.
Yes, I was wondering how do y'all feel about Metallica.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry about that. How do we feel about Metallica?
Metallica?
How do you feel about Metallica? Or rock and roll?
I'm not really that familiar with specific bands of that genre. But I think if you like it, it's wonderful. you know. I like them. I think they're okay. I mean, I've seen their videos and stuff, and I think they're okay. I mean, that, I'm not a fan of that kind of music, but so what?
Yeah. And here we go. Hello, caller.
Couple questions.
Yes.
Why doesn't he think that the local music commercial stations, why don't they play more often regional music, bring it into their collection? Why is it they mention it and they brag about it, but they, you know, because the Austin scene is part of the national scene in reality. Is it too diversified, or you can't categorize it and pigeonhole it? Is that what it is? Or it's just not commercial enough?
That may be part of it, but the other thing is that not all Austin bands are great, you know, and
right.
Some of them make good records, and those should get played, you know, but you can't really, I don't know. I don't work for commercial radio. They're usually run by guys who used to be sales managers.
Oh, yeah. Two more. What about the international market, Europe, Japan?
That's a big
The Far East. Do you think those people like rockabilly and...
They really do. Yeah.
There's a whole new market for the Eastern Bloc. And for countries in the Orient, I think they like American music and always have. Western music, I should say.
They do like that a lot, and there's a lot of Japanese. The Japanese buying everything we've got. They want our culture. That's
well,
next.
I think the Beatles played there when they first toured.
Yeah, they did.
That's final
Ringo
question.
Wasn't on the tour, I think.
Can you look in your crystal ball, Paul, when you're on your rocking chair? What's the music going to look like 20, 30 years from now? Videos will still be here.
Lord,
the
I won't.
Guitars will be here. Pardon me?
I won't.
Well, you might be looking down on us, but...
We're looking up at you.
is there a future, or are we just going to grind it back down in the past and start over again? Thanks.
Well, yeah, like someone said, it is cyclical, and what goes around comes around. I mean, there's all these guys with their pompadours and ducktails, and I mean, when I was in the fifth grade in '53, I had pompadour and ducktails, and now I see these kids who could be my kids with pompadours and ducktails, and I think it's great, you know. There's also stuff that nobody has ever heard before happening now. As far as predicting what's going to happen, man, you can't. Who'd have thunk a bunch of guys with... shag haircuts from Britain would come over here and conquer the world, you know. We thought it was going to be Bruce Chanel forever.
All right, caller, hello.
Yeah, how's it going, Paul?
Well, pretty good.
All right, good to see you on there. Man, I've been listening to your show for years and years, and good to see you on here contributing to the latest deals. And I just want to ask you, man, I guess it's kind of on the point that you're making earlier. The guy was asking, well, gee, how come they don't play more Austin music? And you said, well, gee whiz, maybe they're not all just great albums and stuff like that. And I could completely agree. I mean, as much as I've lived here for over 10 years and I'm really into the scene and all that, there's a lot of, you know, BS going on, too. What do you think about, like, the cliques that are created by, you know, the Chronicle and the Statesman about how, like, certain guys, and I'm not going to mention this name to pick on him per se, but, like, Alejandro Escovedo, okay? He is their man. I mean, he can do no wrong. His shit don't stink. I mean, come on, give me a break. There's a lot of stuff breaking through, and yet this guy's getting pressed. You look at bands like Dangerous Toys, who are not my favorite band, not really into that music, but they sold 500,000 albums. What the hell?
Yeah.
Where's the press? Come on. I mean, what do you think
about
that?
Well, yeah, but you got to realize guys in the press aren't musicians. They're the writers, and they... as far as Alejandro, that whole family's sort of a cottage industry. I mean, look at all the bands and look at all the record deals. Look at all the contracts and rumors of signings and stuff of Alejandro. They've driven that poor guy crazy trying to sign that guy. He's a cottage industry. Sign him, get the advance, spend it, drop him. Somebody else will sign him. And these guys, all these vice presidents, move from company to company, rework a deal. Hey, we can go back and get Alejandro. These guys dropped him, you know, I think the guy's really talented. I think he really is. I think he's got some nice songs and he sings well, and he's got his whole routine together, and that's the whole secret. You just get your show together.
He'll be on this show next weekend.
He's going to be here next weekend? Out of sight. Yeah, I'm a fan. I think he's a talented guy.
All right, cool. Alejandro, I didn't know that. Hello, caller.
Hey, Paul.
Yes, here he is.
Hello.
Hello.
Listen to your TV.
Coming at us.
Uh-oh. Okay, we're going
to
take one more call, and then we will go to videos.
Hi, Paul?
You're here with Paul Ray.
Paul.
Hey.
No, baby.
What are you doing up this late anyway, you little monsters? If you were my kid, you would be, I don't know, no, you wouldn't be my kid.
Hello, caller. Last call for Paul Ray. Are you there?
Last call for Paul.
Well, guess not. Well, you got one lid up here. Oh, let's jump it.
Hey, Lonnie.
Hello.
Who's this?
Huh?
Who wants to know?
It's me, and it's time to go.
Really? You kids go to bed.
Man, thank you so much for coming.
I enjoyed
on the
it.
Show.
Had a great time, Troy.
It's,
thanks.
It's been a pleasure and a great opportunity for me to interview you. And to all our folks out there, KUT, Paul Ray's Jazz, Wednesdays and Thursdays.
Tuesdays and Wednesdays.
I'm sorry. Tuesday. I've been sick. I can't help myself. And of course, Twine Time, I know, is Saturday night because I'm there just about all the time.
6 to 9 o'clock.
And look for him. You're playing around every now and then.
Yeah, every once in a while.
And man, thanks again.
Sure.
And thanks for letting us, giving us some more information. and I always love hearing stuff about the Austin scene. And I think there's a lot of our folks out there who like to hear that stuff too.
Long and strange trip.
Dang straight. Folks, you're watching CapZeyeZ. We're going to go to some videos here, and we'll be back in a little while. Me, I'm Troy Dillinger. I'll be around. We'll have Joe Ely eventually on the show, supposedly. And
allegedly.
Yeah, allegedly. He couldn't make it last week because he was
playing pool.
He was playing pool. And supposedly we'll have, tentatively, I guess, would be Paul Sessoms of the Black Cat and lots of other folks. So keep watching CapZeyeZ. And, of course, there's always Nasty Nathan. And